On Bishop Barra's YouTube channel, you will find exclusive content to uplift your faith. The Word of Faith with Bishop Macedo. Live meetings from Bishop Barra Fonseca. Testimonies, thoughtful advice, prayers, and much more. Do you like it? Then subscribe today and share the videos on your social network. You are listening now to A Word of Faith with Bishop Macedo.
Hello, my dear listeners. May God bless all of you abundantly in the name of Jesus Christ. And I want to give here my best with the Holy Spirit. And I ask that He may open our understanding so that He may give me the right words to meet the need. Your need. I don't want to make just a program. I want this program to reach the main objective, which is to awaken the faith that brings benefits. Faith that will make happen the miracle. Just as James says that God has given faith to the poor. He chose the poor to give them faith. And what kind of faith is this? Faith to believe and see nothing happening? Of course not. He has given us faith and faith to the poor that obeys so that then these poor may take possession of what they don't have in life. So this is the objective of this program. And for this to be clear, I ask the Holy Spirit may show to you how the devil works through bad news, through negative words, to impede people from enrolling and developing their faith and making people not to be able to think. And then they become the problems and impede them from using their faith. Let us hear a testimony right now of people that work with problems and now they have their lives transformed.
My name is Eunice and this is my story. It all started when I was about 5 years old. I remember sitting on the stairs in my house, and the thoughts that I was having was, you know, you were never meant to be born. You're not a part of this family. Nobody loves you. Nobody cares about you. I wish I was dead. I had a lot of family issues, and I know for a fact that's where a lot of those insecurities and low self-esteems came from, because Through all the problems that were happening in my family, it's kind of like I just got lost in the middle of it. Yeah, I used to fall into depression as a preteen and as a teenager. And, you know, throughout all those depressed moments, I would just have no energy. I would sleep all day. I wouldn't eat. I would isolate myself. And I fell into a lifestyle of living very fast, partying every day, partying every weekend, always going out, staying out until the morning. And I started that very young, like, you know, 17, 18. You know, I was experiencing a life that was faster than what I was supposed to experience at the time. And then I started to suffer with nightmares. I couldn't sleep at night. I used to have, you know, strong spiritual oppression. You know, I was smoking weed, and then it just progressed to smoking multiple times a day, smoking all day. Just, you know, not having a sober moment in the day because I was either high or I was drunk or I was both. Life was just spiraling out of control, and it just continued to keep going worse and worse and deeper into the black hole. Through coming to the church, I learned that the church was open 7 days a week, and I made a vow to come to the church every single day and to make a chain of prayer every single day, because I needed a total life transformation. There was not an area in my life that wasn't destroyed. my spiritual life increased. I got closer to God than I ever have before. My mother is my best friend. You know, I can't go a day without hugging and kissing her. I had no love for my mother. Absolutely no love for her. But now, you know, our love is so strong. You know, and the same with my sister. I couldn't stand to be around either one of them, but now they're my best friends. They're my closest friends. My whole life changed through coming here. And it's not just about the blessings that I received, it's about the presence of God that I received. All of my burdens left me when I came to this church. The paranoia left me, the anxiety left me, the depression left me, the suicidal thoughts left me. Today, after coming to the Universal Church, my life is completely transformed. I have peace inside of me. I have peace around me. My family is blessed. I am blessed. And my whole life is just a joy. I'm happy to wake up every single day and to see what God has in store for me.
Hi, my name is Saul Rodriguez. Today I'm blessed. I'm happily married. I got a great job. But my life wasn't always this way. Before I accepted God, my life was meaningless. I didn't care for nobody. I liked drinking. I didn't care for my education. The only thing I cared about was being around the cool guys, which was skipping school, not caring about my grades, going out to parties, going out to parks and start drinking. Didn't care about nobody. I had no vision. Actually, my vision was drinking. My vision was fighting. My vision was going to jail. That was part of the goal I wanted to reach. There was times I got to the point I didn't want nobody to tell me what to do, regardless who it was, father, mother. But of course, as the man in the household, my father needed to be up and set the rules. I got home one day drunk. He told me stop drinking. I started breaking everything in the house. Once he told me to stop, something clicked in me. He's telling you something that you don't want to hear. So we got into a fist fight. Because I didn't see him as my father. I seen him as an enemy, telling me don't do this. And that's when it happened, a big, big, big sin. But I didn't care at that time. So my mentality was I didn't care about nothing. All I care was about drinking. At my house with my wife, fights constant. One day I went to a nightclub. After that, she found out I was there, so I got a phone call. But at this time, I didn't want to argue. For some reason, I didn't want to argue anymore. So I went outside, I flagged a taxi driver down. I told the guy at the end, see you later, my friend. He says, F you, I'm not your effing friend. That's where my mentality clicked again. This guy's disrespecting you. Go out and do something, you know, you can't get disrespected from him. So me not thinking again about the consequences of my actions, I try to fight him in the car. The guy turns around and he runs me over. So from that on, I went to a hospital, Sunnybrook. They gave me 10% survival rate.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power.
At this point, my wife and parents were praying for me in the help center. The doctors did their part, God did his part, and I'm sitting here today. It was a long, painful recovery, but during that recovery, coming to the help center, learning more about God, I had something inside me changed, actually. I was grateful to be alive. As of today, I got a vision. I got goals. I got dreams. I got a beautiful family. I got two wonderful kids. No more drinking. The weekend, no more going out, clubs, partying. It doesn't work for me anymore. Now I have a wonderful job. I know where I'm going, and I'm going to get it. And what I'm trying to say is, if you want to change, you want your life to change, come to the help center. You got nothing to lose but your problems. Today I am blessed.
Maravilhoso.
This is wonderful.
Minha amiga, meu amigo, my dear listener,
pay attention.
Eu fiquei pensando agora,
I was just thinking.
Às vezes eu fico
sometimes
rindo
I even laugh here. You
know,
just a.
Mas
a little, but
é a alegria,
the joy,
o gozo,
it's a pleasure, it's a joy,
que essas pessoas
that these people, they pass through
elas
their testimony, they pass
alegria.
Me this joy,
e que
and
mostra
it shows,
trabalho,
it proves,
que nosso trabalho
it proves that our work
há mais de 40 anos
that
atrás,
has been 40 years in existence.
And this is the reason. You know, it wasn't
my personal interest to have a religious club or to have a specific place only for people that are chosen. No, no, that was not the intention. I believed and I still believe that God is great. And He is great. And He is the Almighty God. And my challenge right now, my cry out to Him in those times was like that. God, if you are great, if you are a living God, if you truly are the living God Almighty, so then these people that are living in hell, they must get out of hell. They have to take possession of your promises and they have to experience of your greatness. They cannot be empty-handed. They cannot just hear stories of the Bible. No, no. There must be a result. There must be an answer so that these people can know that you exist.
And today,
we are being blessed with this joy of the answers that the Holy Spirit has been giving to us. And this testimony proves that these people that became free from addiction, this person that was delivered from diseases and sicknesses, and thanks be to the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of the Mighty God, He has been working in their lives, and today they are testifying. A testimony that I have been trying to show to many others, that I spread it throughout this world. Thanks be to God.
All that I have, I'll sell all that I have to hold in my hand the pearl. Nothing I have can compare with the prize when I hold in my hand the pearl. Brighter than sun, dearer than gold, the pearl. Kingdom of God, it's the kingdom of God. It's life with my Lord, the pearl. All that I have is ashes, is earth. Now that I've seen the pearl, I will not rest, I cannot be content, till at last it is mine, forever to shine, the kingdom of God, the world. Let me gather everything I own, to shine the kingdom of God. The
everyone who does not submit to God's word brings to themselves destruction to their life. Even though they have faith, goals, and dreams, if there is no obedience to God's word, they will certainly be rejected by God. God sees the heart and recognizes those who fear Him and keep their word. And these are the ones who want eternal life, are humbling themselves, repents from their wicked ways, and seek the throne of grace and mercy of God. The Universal Church, empowering lives with the Word of God.
I was in a very serious depression. My daughter passed away when she was 7 years old. She was sick with something called aplastic anemia. A couple of months after she was diagnosed, me and her father was at the store and some gangbangers came up and shot and killed him. And that's where my depression started. It disabled me. It was very crippling. I continued to live my life, but I was going through so much and nobody knew because I kept it inside. After a while, I had to go seek help. I would use the pills that I got to sleep because I couldn't sleep. I would wake up sick. I took 3 different kind of pills. I started abusing them.
Depression was destroying Michelle's life. Then she found the help she needed.
When I came to the Universal Church, they taught me like I was in a college. I'm embarrassed to say I think I sleep too much. No more pills, no more depression, no more insomnia. I'm doing great. I'm doing really good. I love life. If you're going through anything like I was going through, I advise you to find a number and call it and find a Universal Church in your area because they will help you.
This is the God that we have announced. It's not a God like the gods of this world.
It's
a God that's not created by image and invention of mankind, who is beard or no beard, children, adult, old, young. No, my God is a spirit and gives life. And what's more glorious about Him, the most glorious about Him, is that He is just. He is just. I serve a God of justice. And this is what I have been trying to pass on to people. This conscience. Because I know that everyone in this world suffers injustice. Even the rich. Those who are powerful. But are the poor. That they have faith. The poor ones are the ones, the miserable ones, the afflicted, those who are rejected, those who are despised by society, that has faith and that believe, because God has given them faith. God has chosen the poor of this world to give them faith, so that through this faith, these poor may become rich. But one thing that I cannot let you go by is the faith that brings justice, the faith that makes you to conquer what is just, like the case of these testimonies. This faith that we are talking about has as a testimony our offering.
Our offering. Isso mesmo.
That's right.
Fé sem oferta,
faith without offering, there is no way to see the benefits. It is the same as the offering given without faith.
There is,
for example, faith is proved through an offering.
Foi Jesus quem ensinou.
Jesus who taught this.
Veja o texto sagrado.
You can read the scripture with me. And it says, after he had healed a leprous man, look at what Jesus told him.
Olha, não digas a alguém,
see that you tell no one, but go your way, show yourself to the priest, and offer the gift that Moses commanded as a testimony to them.
Você verifica
so you can verify
que a oferta,
that the offering,
amigo,
my dear listener,
ela serve para ser
it serves
testemunha
to be
a favor
witness, testimony,
fé,
either to prove your faith or against your faith.
É isso mesmo.
That's right.
A oferta
the offering
que nós apresentamos,
that we present,
ela é testemunha
it is
a favor,
either a testimony
nós,
against us
porque,
or for our favor.
Caso,
because
leproso,
in the case of this leprous man, the offering was going to be a testimony
dele.
For his
no caso
purpose.
Da viúva, pobre,
in the case of the widow, on the other hand, she only gave two coins that meant nothing. It served as a testimony on her favor.
Da viúva. E Deus aceitou
and God accepted
oferta.
That offering because it was her
e
own.
Deus a honrou,
Jesus honored
certamente.
Her as well.
Porém,
but the offering, the offering of faith, which was from the rich man, which was
a
great amount than the widows, their
dos
offering, the rich offering, it served
como
as testimony
de que
that they, or that offering was not pleasing to God.
Porque a oferta não
because
era
the offering was not pleasing to God. God did not
da
receive
mesma forma
it.
Como Caim e Abel.
The same way with Abel and Cain.
Caim ofereceu
Cain and Abel,
sacrifícios
they both presented sacrifices Deus. To God.
Mas
but
não foi o melhor.
Cain
Deus
was not his best.
Aquela oferta porque
God did not accept Cain's because that offering
dizia, falava
was
contra o
speaking
próprio
against
Cain. Ele disse, olha,
God said, this offering is the leftover.
E Deus sabia que
and
ele
God
poderia
knew
ter
that he
melhor.
Could have done the best.
Então, a oferta,
so the offering,
dizendo, olha,
the offering
ele não fez o melhor.
Screamed, let's say.
Mas quando
that
Abel
was not the best.
Ofereceu
but when
oferta
Abel
agradável,
presented
a
pleasing
Abel
offering, Abel's offering,
gritou,
he screamed,
favor,
shouted on his behalf.
Então, muitas pessoas
so many people,
dão ofertas,
they do give offerings, has been giving offerings in the church.
Mas as ofertas
but the offerings that have been presented is either against you or to bless you.
Essa é a realidade.
This is the fact.
Se a sua oferta
if your offering
é de defesa,
it is to defend you,
testemunha de defesa
it testifies to
então
defend you, so then you are going to reach
Deus.
God's favor.
Se a sua oferta
but if your offering
você,
denies you,
não vai alcançar nada.
You are not going to reach anything.
Deus não vai te amaldiçoar,
God is not going to curse
você não vai receber
but you are not going to receive no answer
é assim que funciona.
From him. This is
então,
how it works. So, when people,
ofertas,
they make their offerings, the offerings are witness, testimony, either to good or to bad, to either reach God's favor or not.
De si porque
because
quer você queira,
whether,
quer
whether
você acredite,
you believe, whether you believe
não,
or not,
não
it doesn't matter.
O que
what matters
é
is what is written.
O Senhor Jesus
and Jesus told this leprous man that was healed to present himself to the priests
e fazer a oferta
and to also present the gift, the offering.
Testemunho.
To testify on his behalf.
Essa é a fé
and that is the faith
universal.
Of the
vamos
universal church. Let us hear more testimonies
da oferta
of faith
como
as testimony for these people's lives.
My name is Chandrika Carter. I was addicted to selling drugs and gambling. I used to go to state trafficking, and one time I came to my residence and I had a gun put to my head by the police and I went to jail. When I went to jail, I stood in jail for 2 weeks. I was facing 25 years to life.
After receiving a sentence of 25 years to life, Chandrika fell into a deep depression.
And I fell into a deep depression stage because I didn't know what to do. I had no one to turn to. I was facing 25 years to life. All the questions that was going through my mind was, who's going to take care of my kids? How am I going to be here? How can I be this single mom and solely provide for them? And this is my outcome. I'm addicted to drugs, I'm selling drugs, but yet I'm facing 25 years. I had no family or friends. No one understood me.
Due to the depression, Shadrika became addicted to painkillers and drugs.
I started taking painkillers, and at first it would start off as one and two, then it moved to three and four. I was addicted to Percocets, Somas, I was taking Xanax. I was even smoking weed. Every once in a while, I drank alcohol. And the hardest one for me to kick was painkillers because I was in a bad car accident. In my mind, I thought I needed it. My body craved for it. Even if you try to kick it, you'll throw up and go through bad withdrawals. And it was just, for years, I was taking and taking. I had the addiction for a little over 2 years. First, it started off as using it as doctor prescribed. With depression, I started taking more. Then it became recreational because everybody I knew was taking it. So even if I go clubbing or I go over to friends' house, it was always there. I didn't want the same thing for my kids. I knew something had to change. It was just a continuous cycle over and over and over and over again throughout my whole family. It was just continuing. My mom was addicted to alcohol. My dad was addicted to crack cocaine. So my grandmother raised me, but even with my grandmother raising me, everyone around me either used or sold drugs. Back then, when I had a problem, I didn't know how to face it. I didn't have the strength to face it. I ran from it, and drugs became my enabler. They made me feel nothing. Like, I didn't think about my problems. I didn't think about anything. It was just a high, like it was an ultimate high. I didn't feel nothing. I became numb. I became numb to love. I became numb to being a mother, being a sister, a daughter, a person. I just feel like I was alone. When I first started coming to church, I'd come maybe once or twice a week. But my youngest daughter started coming 7 days a week. She was faithful with coming. And I was lacking because I had bad experiences with churches before where I was judged, what I wear, how we talk. And I'm like, okay, I don't know if this kind of church is, I'm going to be welcome. So I had my guards up when I first started coming to the church. And after about 2 months, my daughter started coming. She was like, Mom, you really need to come more. I started talking to the pastor and explaining to him how I got into gambling and to drugs. And he told me to start coming to Friday and doing chains of prayer. So I started doing it. And I want to say about 8 months into the church, I just completely stopped everything. I got a job. I'm a supervisor. I have 13 employees under me. I don't even think about gambling now. I'm taking pills. It's gone. No more weed, no more pills, no more gambling, nothing. I don't even have the urge for it. I know for sure, if it wasn't for University Church, I wouldn't be saved. My kids wouldn't. Or my husband, we come to church faithfully now. I mean, we're not perfect, but we're working on us.
The voice of faith, quite the voice of fear. The voice of faith takes away your bad thoughts. The voice of faith brings a certain sweet calm, confidence within my soul that the victory will be achieved. The voice of faith is stronger than iron, even against the great storm. The voice of doubt, the voice of faith, is the cedar never changed. The voice of faith brings the certain sweet calm, confidence within my soul that the victory will be achieved. The great storm, the house you'll never be ruined. The house you'll never be ruined.
I had crime sprees when I was younger, but like those little scrimmages with the junior high and the high school thing, I really didn't get into any real serious trouble until I started doing drugs. When I started doing cocaine in my late 20s, early 30s, that's when I became a real violent person. I was a pharmacy technician for 15 years. I had accomplished a lot of things that I threw all away while doing drugs. And I wasn't your regular, as they say, dope fiend, because I used to have tactics to finagle and finesse you for the drugs. But a drug seller has tactics to maintain the money getting. And that's where the fear and the use of anger comes in. I made decent money, you know. I mean, I could make, you know, $800,000 a day. You know, but at the same time, the same night, I might party up $400 or $500 of it. You know, all of it, and I had to start over again. And I was told about this church, and I said, okay, I'll try one of these days. I was told about it in January, 2009. I said, oh, I ain't gonna go. And then one day, one Saturday, I just said, okay, you know, I need to change. I need to start checking some churches out that can help me. So I need to change. I continued to come. As I continued to come, I found out that the church was open 7 days a week. And you could talk to them about anything, finances, healing, drug addiction, marriage. They had a lot of things to offer. And I could just walk up to the pastor and talk to him about how I felt right then and there and get instruction. What I've seen change in my life is that the anger has died down. I realized that it serves me no purpose. I had problems because I didn't feel I was worthy to ask God of anything, because my past would prohibit me from doing it. I wanted, because I want people to see in me what God has done to a person like me so he can do it for a person like them.
When I went to the doctor for my test, they told me they found 5 lumps in his breasts. I felt lost, lonely, and sad. I'm thinking about my kids, if anything happened to me. I said to myself, I'm not accepting this. I'm gonna fight with everything I have. I come to the church on Friday. I did not break my chain of prayer. I persevere that I'm gonna be fighting this cyst to remove from my breast. And I went back to the doctor. The doctor said, okay, everything is negative. That was the last time I went to the doctor. I am healthy, I am healed in my body, and I'm happy. I am so happy.
My friends, I want to let you know right now that this blessing that happened in their lives, the blessing that took place, it is only due to their offering that they have given to God. And you know why? Because the offering that we place on the altar, which is spontaneous, are not the tithes. Offering is something spontaneous that we offer God. So in that moment that we are bringing our offerings, whether it is an offering of sincerity, if it is the best that we are giving, so it's our life. That offering right there is our life. When God sees, when he sees the offering, he sees my life, he sees your life. And if you just give leftovers, God will not accept.
Ele não vai aceitar o resto.
He's not going to accept leftovers.
Sua vida como
He's
está,
going to accept your life
apodrecida.
As it is, even if it's rotten,
destruída.
Even if it's destroyed.
Mas ele quer tudo.
But he wants
ele
it all.
He
don't want just
dela.
A few moments of your life. He wants it all or nothing.
Então, por isso que a oferta
That is why the offering
é
is testimony either to favor or against
falar,
us. Because the offering will say,
ele é justo.
This person is just.
Ou então a
or the offering
falar,
will say, no,
é
this person is not
tá
righteous, it's not
restou.
Just. He's giving the leftover. He could
Porque
have given more. Because it was exactly that
that
happened
Jesus
when Jesus
ficou olhando
was looking
as pessoas fazerem
people, at
as
people presenting
ofertas.
Their offerings at the temple.
Ele ficou olhando,
he was just observing.
Ele viu que os
he saw that the rich, they were bringing great sums of
era
gold,
ouro, era prata,
silver,
era moedas de ouro,
other coins of gold. And he was watching, and he saw that one
pobre,
poor widow,
pobre, pobre,
poor, out of her misery,
que só tinha duas moedas.
That only had two coins,
então,
and she gave those only two coins
tinha.
Which she had. It was
não
all.
Nada, mas
it was nothing.
Ela deu.
No comparison to the gold.
Dela,
but that offering right there
gritou,
screamed,
Senhor,
saying, Lord,
é justa.
She is being just.
Ela está dando tudo.
She is giving all
toda
that she has
vida.
To you.
Ela está
all her life is here. She is surrendering
Mas
everything.
Ofertas,
and the offerings
ricos,
of the rich,
muito
which
mais.
Were greater
Aquelas
amount,
ofertas,
a great sum,
gritaram, ah,
but those off, that offering
não deram tudo,
was
não. Melhor, não.
Not
eles
showing
deram,
their all.
Tava restando,
this was here,
tava
was a leftover.
Então,
it was just
a oferta,
the tips.
Minha amiga, meu
so,
amigo, no fundo,
the offering, my
é
dear listener,
de cada um.
It represents
é a vida
the
de
life of
ofertante.
Each and every person.
E isso é muito
and
glorioso,
that is very glorious.
A minha oferta,
because my offering,
só eu posso
only
dar.
I can give.
Huh?
Only I can
é
give.
A minha vida.
Because it's my life.
Ninguém pode dar
no
minha
one
vida
can give for me.
Para Deus.
No one can give my life to God. We can
consecrate
the life of a child to God. But that child will have the opportunity to give their lives later on or not. And the offering is exactly that. The offering is testimony of our faith, of our surrender.
Dedicação.
Of our dedication.
Isso,
and I'm saying this and insisting for you who want justice. Whoever wants justice must see the offering with this point of view, with intelligence, with wisdom. Not only to place on the altar a great sum of money, no.
Aquilo que vai
what is going to represent your offering
de
before God?
Vai representar sua
it is going
fé.
To represent your faith.
Vai representar sua
it
dedicação,
is going to represent your dedication.
Porque
because
a gente oferece
we are offering according
fé
to the faith
de
that
nós,
is within
verdade.
Us. Yes or no?
É ou não é?
Yes or no?
É como
it is like love.
Quando a gente ama,
when we love,
a gente quer
we want,
a gente quer casar com a pessoa,
we want to marry. We want to
ela.
Live with them.
Isso quando há amor.
This is when there is
quer
love.
Dizer, não há amor
there
sem
is
oferta.
No love without
não há
offering.
Amor
there is no love without true surrender.
Não é
and for all your
momentos,
life.
Não.
Not for only few months or years.
Exige
love. Demands a total surrender, unconditional love. It's like marriage. It's a covenant. And the same is the offering of faith. The same is faith.
Faith
is a total surrender. Whoever surrenders, surrenders everything. Whoever don't believe, only gives a little bit.
Precioso,
only
mas que não,
gives,
que não representa
but it does not symbolize or represent the entire life.
Então, qualquer que
so,
seja o seu problema,
whatever your problem is, whatever
dor,
is your need,
saiba disso.
Know this.
Você pode resolver.
You can
está
resolve
suas mãos.
It. It is in your hands.
A oferta
the
você
offering
tem.
That you
você
give.
Tem que decidir.
You have to decide.
E todos podem
and
fazer
everyone can
o melhor.
Do the best.
Porque a viúva pobre
because the poor,
fez o melhor,
she did her all and was blessed.
Vamos falar com Deus.
We are going to talk to God.
Oh Lord, come close and hear my cry. I am in need of you.
Holy Spirit, my God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I cry out to you that you may meet this person who has faced, who is facing injustice and does not know how to change the situation using the power of faith that they have. And I know that you have given faith to the poor. And these people that are poor in spirit, who are listening to us, that they may have the courage, because faith requires courage, to offer their lives, to surrender their lives on the altar. And in the name of the Lord Jesus, I ask to all your people, to all the people that believe, and all of you who believe, you say amen, and thanks be to God. Well, my dear listeners, we are coming to the end, and tomorrow we are going to be back at the same time in this station, and always praying to God so that somewhere, somehow, your life and your faith be awakened and renewed so that you may reach God's blessings. May God bless all of you until tomorrow, in Jesus' name.
My God, oh Lord, come close and hear my cry. I am in need of you. Come rescue me, guard my soul, for I am faithful to you.
but nothing will keep me from trusting you. For I'm secure completely in your promises, and in this faith I know that I will overcome. I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor have I seen his descendants beg for bread. I've never seen someone to see the greatness of your power. I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor have I seen his descendants beg for bread. I've never seen someone who believed in you and failed to see of your power. He who trusts in you is never troubled. Look up to the heavens and believes in your power. And in this confidence, I'm victorious. Just like the mountain of Zion, I will remain.